in this chamber is a diamond,
but it's nothing like the kind you'd see in a jewelry store. It's been designed for use as a qubit, or a unit for a quantum computer.
Computers, like your laptop or your phone, run calculations and store information by using a collection of bits, which are essentially switches that can be set to 0 or to 1. But qubits are so much more than that. We could almost call them a different species.
We're your hosts. I'm Katie Sauter.
And I'm Robby Weinbaum. Today, we're going to show you what makes a qubit so powerful.
Last time, we talked about superposition, which is an ability unique to quantum systems. When a system is in superposition, it is in a combination of its possible states. Often, some of these states are weighted heavier than others. It's like having a weighted die.
This is a qubit, the smallest unit of quantum information and the building block of quantum technologies. The basic concept of a qubit is that instead of a switch between 0 and 1, qubits can also be in a superposition of two states that can be used to represent 0 and 1. And because it's a superposition of these two states, we can weigh them however we want relative to each other. For example, we can make it such that the probability of getting a 1 is twice as likely as getting a 0.
This opens up a whole new world of possibilities. A regular bit has only 2 possible outcomes, 0 or 1. But a quantum bit can hold information in the relative weights between its possible outcomes, making them extremely powerful and something completely different than anything we've used for computing before.
This qubit here is not actually the diamond itself. It's a tiny defect inside the diamond. Diamonds are usually made entirely of carbon atoms. But when we replace one carbon atom in the crystal with a nitrogen atom, and take away an adjacent carbon atom entirely, this is called a nitrogen vacancy center, or an NV center. And this defect in the crystal is the quantum system that we're using as a qubit.
To understand how we're going to get our 0 and 1 out of this qubit, we first need to talk about spin. Spin is a property unique to quantum particles, like electrons, protons, and neutrons. We say that a particle can either be spin up or spin down. And since those are quantum states, it can also be in a superposition of both spin up and spin down.
So if the NV center captures an additional electron, quantum mechanics says that we can treat the spin of this electron as the qubit. And the 2 quantum states we use for 0 and 1 are when the electron is spin up or spin down.
But it's not just having a quantum system with 2 possible measurement outcomes that makes something a qubit. You also have to have a way to easily manipulate and measure which state it's in. Spin states of NV centers are fairly easy to manipulate with light and magnetic fields, and to measure it, we shoot it with a laser. This makes the NV center emit light, and the brightness of the light tells us whether the defect is spin up or spin down.
NV centers also make incredible sensors. We can use the sensitivity of their spin states to measure things like pressure, temperature, or electric and magnetic fields, all at the quantum scale.
There are actually many different quantum systems that can be used as qubits besides NV centers, and not all of them use spin to define their 2 quantum states. We can make qubits out of single atoms, single molecules, or superconducting circuits. There are even qubits that use different kinds of defects in different kinds of materials. The key requirement is that they have 2 states that can be used to represent a 0 or a 1.
If you remember from last time, coherence is the ability for a quantum system to stay in a superposition. Keeping a quantum system coherent can be pretty difficult, since any interaction with its environment will make the quantum system collapse out of its superposition and into one of its possible states.
Making sure that nothing interacts in any way with a qubit is a hard problem, but a really important one. Only systems that are in a coherent state are usable for cool applications like quantum computing, because the information they hold is contained in their superposition. Once they decohere, they lose that information.
And to make a quantum computer, we have to put multiple qubits together. But it's not as simple as connecting them with a wire. It's way more quantum than that. We'll need to entangle them. Quantum entanglement is how we connect qubits together, which is how we're able to get such incredible computing power from quantum computers, and how we can send information perfectly securely using quantum communication.
Next time, we'll talk about how quantum entanglement works and how we're using it to make revolutionary technology.
Until next time, you can check out our page here for more content. You can also find transcripts for all of our episodes linked below.